Давайте тогда начнем. Да, начинаем нашу вторую неделю. Вот. Okay, so we start our second week of lectures, and today we continue. Today we continue our investigation of the structural optimization. So when we are able to look into the black box. And by looking into the black box, we are going to improve the efficiency of our optimization schemes. Today we will be speaking about another approach. At the previous lecture, it was smoothing technique. And today we will be speaking about interior point polynomial time, interior point method. So this is a long topic, actually. So this was one of the main directions, or maybe even more the most active directions of research in nonlinear optimization in the beginning of 90s, during all 90s, in the beginning of this century. And actually, the topic is indeed very big. And I think today we will stop somewhere in the middle. So this is our program for two lectures. So, and all of that is, of course, related to this construction of special functions which describe our optimization problem. So let us start maybe from some motivation. So why do we need that? Because actually, the moment when people started to think in this direction, actually, the theory of convex optimization was absolutely perfect. So I mean that there was this complexity theory for black box methods, so which tells us how fast can be optimization algorithm. And in all classes at that time, so we had optimal methods, so which implement this efficiency bound. So therefore, the impression was that this field is done completely. But still, so at that moment, we started to understand that actually black box model maybe is not so perfect. Look, so all assumptions in this field are done about the size of certain derivatives. So we can think about Lipschitz continuous functions or functions with Lipschitz continuous gradient, or so the next step, so Lipschitz continuous Hessian, and all things like that. Now, but if we look at some examples of functions, so we can see that maybe so these assumptions are not so good. Let us look. So what do I mean? So let us kind of look at the function of two variables. Yeah, so this is x2 squared divided by x1. So x1 must be positive, of course, in this expression. And at zero, so we define this function as equal to zero. So you can easily check that this function is convex. On the other hand, so it is discontinuous at the origin. So let us look what happens. So we have this strange domain of convex function. So x2 must be positive everywhere except the point zero. And if you go to the origin, so inside the domain, and using the curve that x1 is equal gamma x2 squared, okay, this is a parabola, this is x1, okay, you see that then f along this curve is equal to 1 over gamma. Yeah. So therefore, choosing different gamma, we get different limits. So the function is discontinuous at the origin. So, and of course, if it is discontinuous at the origin, so we cannot even speak about some bounds on the derivatives, clearly. So we never have any reasonable bounds for this derivative. So from the point of view of the standard black box optimization theory, so this function is very bad. So we don't want to look at it, so we don't want to minimize it, and all things like that. On the other hand, so let us look at its epigraph. What is it? We introduce one variable x3, and we say x3 is greater or equal than x2 squared divided by x1. Yeah? And this is the epigraph. Then, so with simple change of variables, okay, so we say x1 is equal u1 plus u3, x3 is equal u1 minus u3, and x2 equal to u2. So then you can easily see that this inequality is equivalent to this one. Okay, please. This one. And this is already a very nice set. So in it appears in many applications. So, and it is called Lorentz cone or ice cream cone or whatever. So, and its epigraph, of course, is very nice. This is just the epigraph of Euclidean norm. Very nice set, and of course we can use this set in optimization without any problems. So what was bad with functional representation of this guy? So it was just the bad choice of coordinate axis. So we just choose x3 like that, and x1 and x2 like this. And of course, from this point of view, so the function is very bad. So this shape as a function, as the epigraph of the function, is very bad. So we have discontinuous function, which we with which we have problems with derivatives. But if you just change variables, so everything becomes perfect. So this is a nice convex set. So which this is a kind of signal that actually functional representation of our components, the components of our problem, maybe is not very good. So it doesn't work directly with the geometry or topology of our objects. So it works with functional representation. And it is very easy actually to do mistake. So in choosing the right coordinates in this representation and get bad functions. So therefore the question which arises after this simple example is like this. Can we always represent the functional components of our problems by convex sets? Okay, because as the set, the epigraph of this function is perfect, but is a function, so it is terrible. So why don't we use always the convex sets instead of a functional representation of the problem? And the answer is, of course, yes. So it is always possible to pass to the epigraph, and after that, so to do some transformation of variable and use, so instead of all our components, the epigraphs. And in this case, so it is very easy to get so-called the standard formulation of the problem, where there is no functions. There is no function. There are only sets. So the standard optimization of formulation of the problem is as follows. We just minimize linear objective function, okay? So with linear objective function, everything is okay with all derivatives, okay? And the all non-trivial information about our problem is included in this set constraints. Set is not simple anymore, so but it is a closed convex set, so with non-empty interior. So this is the standard optimization problems which we are going to consider in this lecture. Now, in order to solve this problem, we need to move somehow inside this set, yes, to generate the points with better and better values of the objective function. So therefore, we need some tools for measuring the quality of our point inside this set. Of course, maybe the most straightforward characterization of our point is just the residual. We have the linear objective function, so somewhere here, this is the optimal value of our problem. Okay, and of course, for us, it is important what is this gap. Interesting. So, of course, it is important, okay, but it is not very informative because recall you that we need to solve this problem to minimize this objective function. It's not very informative just because it doesn't depend on the position of our point at this hyperplane. And it is clear that if our point is close to the boundary of our set, then it is difficult to improve. So very soon, so we will touch the boundary of convex set. And the boundary of convex set can be very complicated. Actually, so in all convex optimization problems, so which are solvable with good efficiency, so we never exploit somehow the structure of the boundary of convex set, because very often so it is extremely complicated, it has combinatorial structure, and it is very difficult to move along the boundary and even near the boundary. So therefore, we want to be far enough from this boundary in order to have a sufficient space to improve the quality of our point, okay, and to move towards the optimal solution. So the conclusion is that for that we need to introduce so-called barrier function. Barrier function, so this is a function which is defined on the interior of our domain and which goes to infinity when x approaches the boundary of our set. This is a very old, actually, concept. This idea came to the mind of people in the 60s, beginning of 60s, actually. So very natural concept. But at that time, actually, they didn't understand the importance of some properties of this function which ensure the good global complexity results for this approach. So this was done only in the end of 80s and the beginning of 90s. So let us look. So what we can do with this barrier function? With this barrier function, we can introduce so-called central path. So again, so our problem is minimization the linear function subject to the constraint x belongs to the feasible set Q, and we have the barrier function for this set Q. So what is this central path? This is a solution of this equation Tc plus f prime of x equal to zero. This solution of this equation. Or in other words, so this is the minimizer of the penalty function in this form. So the minimizer of the function psi t of x, which is t cx plus psi of x. If you write down the first order optimality condition for this function, you immediately get this central path equation. Now, so why this construction is natural? Just because look what happens if you divide this function by this t. Okay, t is a positive parameter. Then, so you will have here the your objective function, yeah, so the guy which we want to minimize, plus something which is divided by t. What is this? This is a barrier function. So which means that if t is big, so then, more or less, in the most part of our set, so this additional term goes to zero. So it becomes infinitely big when we approach the boundary. But we can reduce this the volume of these bad points by increasing t. So therefore, when t goes to infinity, so we can be sure, with very mild assumptions actually, that the solution, this central path, goes somehow to the optimal solution of our problem, goes to optimal solution to our problem. Okay. So, but since we are interested in the complexity estimate, so we need to describe somehow the quality of these points when t goes to infinity, we need to assume something about our barrier function. And the natural assumption about this barrier function is like that. We assume that the variation of the gradient of our barrier functions with respect to the current point is bounded. It is quite a natural assumption. Look what happens. We are staying at some point x. We compute the gradient. And look at this linear form. So how much we can increase this form staying inside the feasible set. Of course, the gradient goes to infinity when we approach the boundary. Therefore, it is not uniformly bounded. Therefore, this question is non-trivial. So it is easy to see the barrier functions for which the bounds for this variation goes to infinity or equal to infinity. Okay, but these functions are bad. What we want for the good function is that variation of this big linear form, so on this feasible set, is bounded. So why do we need this? Just because of the following fact. Then we can relate the quality of the points on the central path with the value of this penalty coefficient. How to do that? Let us look. So we minimize our function, therefore this difference, okay, this is a difference of the objective function at the point x star and at the optimal value, so this gap. So we need to bound it from above. So how we do that? From the first order optimality condition, yes, we see that this is equal 1 over t, this c is 1 over t minus f prime of xt. Okay, therefore here we change the sign of the points. And this is already the construction of that type. So this guy is bounded by A divided by T, which comes from the first order optimality condition. You see then, so we're able to guarantee that for big values of penalty parameter, so we have close the value along the center path close to the optimal values. And now we can look just at the path following scheme. So what is path following? So the notation was x. Okay, let us look at that. So this is x star of t, the central path. For certain value of tk, okay, so we are close to the central path, to the point x star of tk. After that, we increase the penalty parameter. Our point moves along the central path. Okay, and our goal is to ensure that we are able to compute a good approximation to this new point at the central path. How to do this? Of course, for that, so we just use this functional definition of the central path as a minimum of this penalty function. So this means that for that, we need to apply some methods with new values of the coefficients dk plus 1 to our penalty functions. So our goal, okay, we need to find a powerful minimization scheme which is able to do that in an efficient way. So this is very, very simple idea. And actually, again, so this is an idea of 60s, which was not supported by the right theory up to the beginning of 90s. Now, the main candidate, of course, for that is the Newton method. So this is the most powerful schemes which converge quadratically with local quadratic convergence. So let us try to understand how we can do this with the Newton method. So let us look, what do we know about this Newton scheme? So we already had actually the lecture, the whole lecture about these schemes, but about regularization of these methods, so which was necessary in order to ensure global rate of convergence. But now we need to look at the local rate of convergence, because for updating the good approximation of the point at the central path, so we need some fast local behavior of the method. So what do we know? So this classical Newton methods, now everything is okay about it, so we can assume that we're working with functions where the Hessian is always positive definite, so we can use the classical Newton formula. Now we assume, so these are exactly the Kantarovich assumptions, so that the Hessian is non-degenerate, so there is this L bigger, strictly greater than zero, which ensures this inequality. The Hessian is Lipschitz continuous. Okay, here I write it in all space, but we needed this only locally. And this is important, our starting point is close enough to the solution. Okay, so this is the locality assumption. So this neighborhood of the solution where we can have this quadratic convergence can be computed using the parameters of our function. So this small L and big M. Now, if this happens and we start our process close enough to the solution, then everything is very good. So we do not leave this neighborhood for all next iteration of our process, and we have the quadratic convergence of this method. So the main part here, thing here is on the right hand side, we have the squared residual at the, in the previous point. So the number of right digits in our approximation of the optimal solution is doubled after each iteration of this scheme. So very fast convergence, very good. So what is important actually in this theory, simple theory, that we have the description of the region of quadratic convergence. And it is given in terms of standard Euclidean metric. So how we can see this, that this is the standard Euclidean metric? Just because of that. Only if we use the standard Euclidean metric, then the local strong convexity is equivalent to this matrix inequality, that this matrix in the matrix sense is bigger than identity operator. Yeah, so this means that we are using here the standard Euclidean metric, and which comes from the standard Euclidean product. So, and you see, actually, we can think that maybe we want to change the variables in our problem and to look at this new function again. So then, clearly, so if we are doing that, so this description of the neighborhood of quadratic convergence so will be changed, because in the new metric, if you have here, for example, a positive definite matrix B, so this constant will be different, and this constant will be different, and the region of quadratic convergence will be different. And actually, this is very unnatural for the Newton method. So let us look. So what we can say about this scheme. So consider a function which satisfies our assumptions. And let us do what we just discussed. So we change variables. So from our first function, we form a new function phi, where instead of x, we plug in the product of non-degenerate matrix A by our new variables y. Okay, so we just introduced new coordinates, if you want. Then, okay, A must be non-degenerate, and let us compare two versions of the Newton method. First is generated for our initial function, f of x. This is the sequence xk. And the second is generated again by the Newton method, but applied to the function phi, our function phi. Okay, so the only assumption which we do is that the starting point for our second sequence can be obtained from the starting point in our first sequence using this linear transformation of variable. Then it is easy to see that the whole sequence for the next, for the second function is a linear image of our previous sequence. Why this is true? So the proof is just in one line. So we assume that yk is a linear image of xk for some k equal to zero, and this is true for k equal to zero. Okay, and after that we just look what happens for the next point. So this is the formula for the next y in terms of the function phi. Now we substitute here the derivatives of phi computed from this formula. So what is this? This is the second derivative of phi. Okay, we two times differentiate this construction, in A, and we get this. This is the gradient of phi. And since matrix A is non-degenerate, so here, so this A cancels. And what we get, so is this. Yk is dead from our assumption. So you see that this is the image, again, the image of the point xk plus 1. So this is a very simple observation which tells us that the Newton method is invariant with respect to the choice of variable. This is an invariant scheme. And therefore, its region of convergence should be also a fine invariant. It shouldn't depend on our choice of coordinates, which means, again, that in this classical theorem from Kantarovich, so something is missing. So we miss the affine invariant description of the region of quadratic convergence of this scheme. So this will be our, let me say, first observation, which we are going to eliminate somehow. Okay, the region of quadratic convergence of Newton metric shouldn't depend on the metric which we use in our space. So what was wrong in our description? Let us try to understand, because actually this story is very short, so we did only couple of steps. So our old assumption was that our second derivative is Lipschitz continuous. Again, so the metric here is the standard Euclidean. So let us rewrite it a little bit just to have more convenient objects. For that, we define the third derivative of our function along direction u. What is the third derivative? It's just the usual definition of the derivative. Yeah, so we get our objects, so computed at the shifted point, so subtract the object at the initial point, okay, and divide by this step size alpha. So these two guys are matrices, so therefore this difference is matrix, and therefore the limit is a matrix. So the value of the third derivative along direction is a matrix. So what we say about this matrix is that the norm of this matrix, just divide this stuff by the right hand side and take the limit. So our assumption was that the norm of this matrix is smaller than the norm of this direction. Fine, so let us rewrite it maybe in more convenient way. So just using the definition of Euclidean norm, matrix norm, so we can rewrite this inequality in this form, the equivalent form. So if we maximize here, so this inequality in V with the norm of EV equal to 1, so we come back to our initial definition, our initial inequality. But now let us write it in this form, just because then in the left-hand side we have an affine invariant object, okay, because this is the directional derivative of our function and along three directions, u and two times v. But in the right-hand side, so we have something strange, actually. So in the right-hand side, we have some measurements of this direction in norm, which has nothing common with our particular function f. Therefore, if we want to replace our bad assumption by a good assumption, so we need to do something with the right-hand side of this inequality. In other words, so we need to find an affine invariant right-hand side of this inequality. And what it can be, so it is more or less evident, so this what we can do in this situation. So we need to replace these norms by the norm which is closely related to our function, to our objective function. Okay, we just introduce here the norm which is related to directional derivative, and again, so this is the directional derivative of set second degree, and so this is it. Yes, f2 prime uu. This is a local norm of u defined in terms of the Hessian. Yes. No, no.
Just
at this moment, it's just convex because this is defined for arbitrary matrices. It must be a positive semi-definite. This is the only thing we need to assume. Okay, and then so we get a class of functions, very interesting class of functions, which is called self-concordant functions, in Russian самосогласованные функции. Okay, where the right-hand side in this inequality is replaced by this term. So this is what we will study in the next 15 minutes. These are self-concordant functions. Now, what is it? So we need to give the definition, but you already know what is the definition. Let us put it formally. So we have a function defined on an open domain, okay, and which is closed and convex. Fine, so this is natural. So let us take a point x inside the domain and let us choose arbitrary direction in our space, Rn. Now we form a function of one variable, so we move from the point x along the direction u with certain step size t, and we are starting to compute derivatives. We compute the first derivative of our function. Okay, this is this, the gradient multiplied by the direction. We compute the second derivative of our function. This is at zero, so all derivatives are at zero. Okay, this is that, the local norm of our direction. But unfortunately, we need one more. Okay, so we need the third derivative. Third derivative along direction u, which is this. Okay, again, the matrix multiplied two times by direction u. And we need to assume something, some relations between these derivatives. So the definition is that function f is called self-concordant if we have this inequality for all x in our domain and all direction u in Rn. This is the definition of self-concordant function. And again, so the goal, so why we are doing that, so at this moment, so we just want to find the class of functions which are good for a fine invariant Newton method. So this is our motivation. So we introduce this derivative, this definition, and of course we cannot expect these functions arise very often in applications, and this is okay for our goal because we need them just to form some descriptors, so the barrier descriptors of our convex set. So we will see later how it works. But in principle, so we at this moment we just need to be sure that we have enough, let me say, the family of self-concordant function is rich enough. Okay, now, and this is our hope. Our hope is that they are good for the Newton method. So let us check, so what functions are self-concordant. Let us look. Linear function. Let me write down the definition. So how it was posed here. So d3 f of x u less or equal to 2 times norm of u f2 prime of x to the power 3. And the power 3 here is just because we want to have possibility to scale this direction. Yes, so it's related to the fact that in the left-hand side, this is 3 linear form. And this local norm of, I think later, so maybe we'll use this notation, which is the same. X square is f 2 prime of x u u, the local norm of the gradient. So this is the same as this. Okay, so let us check which functions are self-concordant. Linear functions. For linear functions, second derivative is equal to zero, third derivative is equal to zero, therefore this inequality is good, is okay, is valid. Convex quadratic function. For quadratic function, third derivative is zero. So again, for quadratic functions, we have this inequality, so also the second family of self-concordant functions. Now, let us look at more complicated functions. Logarithmic barrier for array. Okay, one variable, real variable, which must be positive, and we form f of x as minus log of x. So in order to check self-concordance, we need to differentiate. So this is the only problem with this function. We need to compute derivatives. First derivative is minus 1 over x. Second derivative is 1 over x squared. Third derivative is minus 2 divided by x cubed. Okay. And if you look at this inequality, you can see that it is satisfied as equality. So this guy is just equal to that. So this is, by the way, the reason why we put here the constant 2, just to have the appropriate scaling for this very important example of self-concordant function, logarithmic barrier for the array. So this definition of self-concordant function so is satisfied with equality. Now, this is not all. So we also can think about logarithmic barriers for a quadratic region. So let us do some efforts and compute so all these derivatives. So we have the function. Matrix A is positive semi-definite. So we take it with minus. So therefore, this is the concave quadratic functions, and we want to consider the region when this function is greater or equal to zero. Let us define, put it positive function inside the logarithm and take it with minus. So we get a logarithmic barrier for a quadratic region. So now our goal is to prove that this function is self-concordant. So what we have no choice, we need to compute derivatives. Let us do that. So again, phi is this. Therefore, the first derivative of this function is the derivative of minus log. It is minus 1 divided by phi, multiplied by the derivative of this stuff along direction u. This is au minus axu. So this is our first derivative. Okay, next step, second derivative. So let us differentiate that. Again, derivative of this phi, it is 1 over phi squared multiplied by derivative of phi along u. This is again that. So we get this guy, the squared displacement, and the squared directional derivative, plus the derivative of this thing in u. So this, derivative of this guy, of x in u. So u is a constant vector, so the derivative of this stuff is zero, and derivative of this is a u u. So we get the second derivative. And now the last step. Okay, so in this self-concordance, it is always like that, so we need to compute all these long expressions, but believe me, again, so by differentiating this along direction u, so we get this formula. And now looking at this formula, you can see that it is not so difficult. At least, so we have some repeated parts so in all these three objects. So if we denote this stuff by omega 1 and this stuff by omega 2, you can easily see that the second derivative can be written as omega 1 squared plus omega 2, and the third derivative can be written in this way. Okay? And then it is easy to see that the absolute value of the third derivative is smaller than 2 times the second derivative in the power 3 divided by 2. Let me write it why this is easy. Okay, so we consider the ratio of d3 divided by d2 to the power 3 divided by 2. Okay, these two guys. And we divide the numerator and denominator by omega 1 cube. By omega 1 cube. And then, so we denote by alpha omega 2 divided by omega 1 squared. Omega 2 divided by omega 1 squared. So what happens if we divide this by omega 1 cube? It will be 2 minus 3 alpha with this notation. Yes? What happens with this guy? When we divide it by omega 1 cube, it will be, okay, it will be 1 plus alpha to the power 3 divided by 2. Okay? This is the ratio of these two guys with this new notation. And then, so we can see that this by convexity greater or equal 1 plus 3 over 2 alpha, the denominator. Okay, and therefore this ratio is less or equal than 2. So this is the thing which we proved this inequality. So this is the definition of our self-concordant function. So we already have very important fact that all quadratic regions which can be written in this way, they have self-concordant barriers, so which are just the logarithmic barriers applied to this quadratic function. Now, let us speak about simple properties of our functions. First one, so if f1 and f2 are self-concordant functions, then the sum of them is self-concordant functions. Note that here we don't put the coefficients, because the coefficients, this is not, this statement is not correct. Or if you want, so it is correct only if the coefficients are greater or equal to 1. But for us, it is important that the sum is self-concordant functions. Now, if function is self-concordant, then, and we put inside the linear transformation of variables, then we also get a self-concordant function. Why this is true, let us prove that. But actually, there is some general reason for this fact. And the reason is that the definition of self-concordant function is done in terms of directional derivatives. Okay, and we will see that if we do something in terms of directional derivative, then so we if our class is defined in terms of directional derivative, then so this transform this class is always affine invariant. Let us look, so what happens. So we have this linear map, okay, y is a function of x. So if we differentiate x in direction u, change u, here we have au, and this is the differentiation of y of x along direction u. Now, what is the first derivative of our function? This is a gradient of this guy multiplied the derivative of this linear operator. This is ay. And this is what? This is just the gradient of our initial function multiplied by this direction v, v which is an image of u. The second derivative, again, differentiated this again, x along direction u, we get this. And this is the gradient of our, the Hessian of our initial function multiplies to time by v. The same story with the third derivative. Again, the third derivative of our new function is the third derivative of our old functions along the direction v. Now, whatever are the inequalities which we assume about our initial functions, so they should be valid for all possible directions, they are, of course, valid if we restrict our set of directions. Now, v is not necessarily the whole set of directions in Rn, but maybe only a restriction of that. But still, so for them, so the inequality is valid. Therefore, whatever we assumed here, and we assumed exactly that, okay, the corresponding inequality will be valid for the function phi. So from this way we define our problem class, so self-concurrent function, so we get that this class is a fine invariant with respect to the linear transformation of variable. And as a consequence, we already have non-trivial example of self-concurrent function. So this is this. Yes, so we have the intersections of ellipsoids. Okay, we sum up the logarithmic barriers for that, and we get a self-concurrent function. Okay, so you already see that we have non-trivial family of self-concurrent function, but let us look at the main, geometric properties. And all these geometric properties can be derived from one very simple fact about this strange object. Look what we are doing. So we take a point x in the domain, and we fix arbitrary direction in Rn. Now we move from this point x along this direction. And what we are doing, we're measuring the size of this direction u using the metric at the new point. Okay, so we are changing the point. The Hessian is changing, therefore this measurement is changing. So we have a function of displacement, function of one variable. Why this function is interesting for us? Just because it appears that for all feasible t, okay, not all t are feasible, so but t equal to zero is feasible. After that, when we maybe intersect the boundary of the domain, so it will be infeasible. But if it is feasible, then the absolute value of derivative of this function is less or equal to one. So it looks quite mysterious because actually the function is somehow difficult to describe, but everything becomes evident if we look at the derivative of this guy. The derivative of this guy is this ratio. Okay, so if you differentiate this stuff along direction t, so you get that. And this is exactly so the thing which we have in the definition of self-concurrent function. So the definition of self-concurrent function is that the absolute value of this fraction is less or equal than one. Therefore, this fact is equivalent to our assumption on the definition of self-concurrent function. Okay, so let us look at the consequences. And the main consequence here is, again, very trivial. So the domain of our function phi contains the interval minus phi of 0 and plus phi of 0. So why it is this? Why it is this? So we have this function phi. No. We have this function phi, which is defined at zero. We look at it, its value at this point, phi equal to zero. Now, we know that the absolute value of its derivative is less or equal to one. Therefore, if we look at the graph of this function, it cannot escape from these two segments. So it goes somehow like this. And this is phi of t. Okay. Now, what are the points where we go out from the domain of our function. So these are the points where the second derivative, we approach the boundary actually, and this is the points where this guy, okay, goes to infinity. So which means that, because this function never goes to plus infinity. So plus infinity cannot be, yeah, because of this Lipschitz continuous. Plus infinity cannot be the reason for the end point of the domain. So what can happen? So it can happen that this guy goes to infinity. Yes, and then, so at this point, so it happens this, and this cannot happen before we cross this point, phi equal to zero, and this is plus of 5,0 and minus 5,0. This is 5,0. This is the picture. So if we compute the value of this function f t equal to zero, we know how far we can go in the positive direction and negative direction, and remaining in the definition, in the domain of our function. Okay, this is more or less what I said. Okay, so this is the interval which is contained in our domain. And the conclusion, so this fact can be written in multi-dimensional form. So for that, we need to define the ellipsoid along the around the point x. So in this sense, using this metric, yeah, so metric which is defined by the Hessian. And the consequence is that all this ellipsoid is contained in our domain if the radius is strictly smaller than one. Okay. So why this is true? This is true that from x we can go to the point x plus, yes, x plus u divided by norm of u x. So this point, at least, okay, so with this coefficient r, which r is smaller than one. Okay. And this means that this point y, of which we have y minus x norm of x equal to one is strictly smaller than one, and y belongs to the interior of our domain. And this is the multidimensional interpretation of the statement. And again, so now it is very, the situation is very good. If we are staying at some point x, we already know the whole set around this point, which belongs to our feasible set. And I recall you our initial goal and our initial problem. So we want to minimize the linear function over this set. So here we have a kind of ball around the set, and we can improve our function just moving inside this ellipsoid, and our function remains feasible. So indeed, so we already have something, a convenient description of the local geometry of ours. Okay, this is the main fact about self-concordant functions. Now, but in order to write down the methods for this function, so we need some inequalities. And all these inequalities, they will be direct consequence of this, let me say, definition, this equivalent definition of self-concordant functions, so this phi prime of t less or equal than one. So let us look at this ellipsoid. This ellipsoid is called Dedekind ellipsoid. So the theorem is like that. So we take two points from our domain, and we want to measure the distance between y and x with respect to the point x and compare it with to the same measurement with respect to the point y. Since the Hessian is changing, of course, these two measurements, they will be different. The question is how much? And this is the answer. This is the lower bound for the measurement of the same distance looking from the point y as compared from this distance measured with respect to the point x. Okay, if the distance between these two points is strictly smaller than one, so this is true for arbitrary guys. But if we are inside this Dedekind ellipsoid, then we have the upper bound for this distance. You see that locally up to the locally up to the term of the second degree, these two measurements, they coincide, but after they diverge, but we know with which rate, so the bounds for the rate of these divergences. Fine, so let us prove this, because this is very simple. Let us choose u, denote u, so the difference between y and x. We then say that 1 over this measurement. So what is this? This is our function phi at 1. So again, phi of t this is 1 divided by f2 prime x plus t u 1 over 2 t u. Okay. So u is y minus x, t is equal to 1, therefore phi of 1 is 1 over this measurement. And we know, and phi of 0, it is 1 over this measurement. Again, so from this form. And we know that our function is Lipschitz continuous with Lipschitz constant 1, therefore phi of 1 is less or equal than phi of 0 plus 1. This is our lemma. And this is exactly this inequality. So just divided by 1 over this measurement and 1 over this guy, and you get exactly this. So this bound is simple. The other bound is also simple. So if this distance is smaller than 1, so phi of 0 then is bigger than 1, yes, because phi of 0 is this. And in view of our lemma, and again, Lipschitz continuities, phi of 1 is bigger than phi of 0 minus 1. And this is this inequality. Okay. So this will be, again, the basis for our next inequalities. So norm of y minus x, x greater or equal norm of y minus x. Oh, here it is y, x, 1 plus norm of y minus x, x. And now we can use it for another inequalities. So this is the theorem. So as usual, we're interested in the rate of growth of the difference of the gradient as compared to the distance, but now between points, but now the distance is local, so it is measured with respect to s. And also the rate of growth of the value of the function with respect to the linear approximation. And again, now we can prove this, where this function omega actually is will be important. Omega to t minus logarithm 1 plus t. Okay. Now the proof. Proof, we just use this fact in integration formula. So denoted by y of tau, this intermediate point between y and x. Okay, r is the distance from I of y and x with respect to x. So then this difference can be written in the integral form as the integral of the second derivative. Okay, and the derivative of y of tau is this. Okay, now, so in order to apply this inequality, okay, we need to multiply the difference of the point two times by the Hessian at the corresponding point. So therefore here we divide it by 1 over tau square and multiply this by tau and this by tau, then this will be y of tau minus x, y of tau minus x. So this is this measurement. And now we apply this guy. Okay. So we apply this guy, tau square cancels, and the right hand side we get this simple integral, which we are able to take. Okay, and then so this is it. So this is the result of our integration. Result of our integration. The first inequality. And for the second inequality, we again do the same thing. So we represent this difference in the difference integral, and we already use the fact which we just proved. Okay, this is this inequality. I prove it here, and again, so we get an integral of one variable, which we can easily compute. Just simple integration gives us this omega of r. So omega of r, just let us, so it is important function in our analysis. It looks like that. So you are speaking about this function. So at zero, it has zero derivative, and it is positive, and it grows slightly. Okay, the growth is slightly smaller than logarithmic is smaller than the growth of t. Okay. So and its gradient, its derivative, t divided 1 plus t, it goes to 1, finally. Fine, now, so here we had these lower bounds. Now we'll put the upper bounds, just because, so if we write it in this way, we put here minus. Okay, but now we say that our point y is close enough to the point x. Then we can do the same tricks with this scalar product and the difference of function with the linear prediction. And we get these two inequalities, but already with respect to this function omega star of t, which is minus t minus log 1 minus t omega prime star of t is t divided by 1 minus t. So this is omega of t. This is, again, the guy which has zero derivative at zero. And it grows to infinity when t approaches the boundary. Actually, this notation with star is not by chance. So it can be easily proved that these two functions are Fenchel conjugate. So you can easily check it yourself. Okay, so the proof is exactly the same. The proof is exactly the same as for lower bounds, therefore we didn't look at it. And I should mention also the main theorem, which we are not going to prove because it takes some time, but it is easy to remember that. So in this Dicking ellipsoid, so with radius r, it appears that the Hessians are almost proportional. They are not changing too much with respect to the Hessian at the center. So everywhere here, okay, the Hessians are more or less the same. The Hessians of, sorry, this should be small f, of course, it is not big f. Should be small f. The Hessians are proportional. So this gives us reason, the possibility to work inside this ellipsoid, so with self-concordant function, more or less in the same way as we work with quadratic functions, because all these functions have almost the same Hessians. Now, this thing has some evident corollary, so that the integral of the Hessian also is proportional, but this is again, so just the consequence of this, these two inequalities. So again, so the integral, the average Hessian, is also proportional to the Hessian in the center. So by the way, so from this inequality, okay, so we have already something which tells us that the information which we have about our self-concordant function is not local anymore. So formally, it looks the same, absolutely in the same style as we have in the black box things. We're speaking about function value, we're speaking about gradient, we're speaking about Hessian. Okay, but it appears that these objects already give us some global information. And this is visible from the following statement. If our domain contains no straight line, so which domain contains no straight line? For example, bounded domain contains no straight line, or the epigraph of quadratic function contains no straight line, or the cone, so like that, contains no straight line. So all if these guys contain no straight line, then the Hessians at all interior points are positive definite. Okay, in convex function we never have situation like that. So Hessian is a local measurement. So and we can easily check or change it a little bit to make it degenerate without possibility to change our function, I don't know, far enough from this point. This change, local change, is always compatible with any assumption we make on our derivatives. And here the situation is completely different. So measuring the Hessian, and if we see that the Hessian at our point is positive definite, then this is it. So we never have the sets which contain a straight line, and moreover, all other Hessians are also non-degenerate. Why it is so? So it is just because of this fact that the Dedekind ellipsoid is contained in our set. Okay, so assume that our Hessian is degenerate at the point x. This means that the Dedekind ellipsoid in some direction is zero, so it becomes a kind of cylinder, and it belongs to the feasible set, so it is unbounded. Okay, and therefore our set contains the straight line, which contradicts to our assumption. You see, now the local measurements provides us with the global information. Okay, now, so let us move slowly to our main goal. So how we can minimize the self-concordant functions. So let us consider this problem. It was not our initial problem, which was there, but just, let me say, the auxiliary problem. So we want to find the minimum of self-concordant function. And our assumption is, now it is a natural assumption, we know why we need that, so that our domain contains no straight line, therefore all Hessians are non-degenerate. And in the same way we introduce the local norm for displacement, so we can, using the Hessian, we can introduce the local norm for the linear functionals. And linear functionals, so like gradients. Therefore, we can measure the local norm of the gradient, very important characteristics for us, which has this formula again. So you see the gradients must be multiplied by the inverse Hessian. And direction, the direction they must be multiplied by the Hessian itself. So let us denote this local norm of the gradient. Remember that here it is 1/2. So this is a local norm, not the squared local norm. Okay, therefore the theorem is, again, so this is a story about the locality and all things like that. So it shows that our measurements are not local anymore. So if at some point our local norm is strictly smaller than one, then we can guarantee that the solution of this problem exists and it is unique. Okay. Again, some measurements somewhere tells us about something about the global structure of our problem. Let us prove this. So for that we use one of our inequalities, namely this one, okay, with the function omega. And we estimate the right-hand side, so it is valid for all y in our domain, right-hand side from below. How we do that? So it is just Cauchy-Schwarz applied to this metric. Okay, this is our lambda. This is our lambda, and this is our function omega. This is our function omega. Now you can see what happens. Lambda is strictly smaller than one. Therefore, the decrease of this function is compensated with increase of this function. You see the coefficients for the main term in this function, t, is one. And here the coefficients for this term is smaller than, absolute value smaller than one. Therefore, so it is this term here is stronger than that. And of course it is stronger, the difference of these two guys, this and the linear term here, is stronger than the logarithm. Therefore, the conclusion is that the level sets of these sets are bounded. So if the level sets are bounded, this means that the minimum exists and it is unique since the Hessians are non-degenerate. And this was is a consequence that the domain contains no straight line. So this is it. So we get this important result. And again, so this looks very unusual from the viewpoint of the standard, let me say, theory of convex functions. Just look at example, actually, what does it mean? Let us take a small, arbitrary small epsilon, positive epsilon, and let us look at this function. Yeah? Epsilon x minus logarithm of x. Of course, logarithmic term is weaker than this guy, but still, so if you look, so and for epsilon bigger than zero, okay, then this function is bounded from below, but its minimum is the solution of the equation epsilon is equal to 1 over x. So x, its solution is 1 over epsilon. And if epsilon goes to 0, then of course, it can be arbitrarily far from our test point, which is x is equal to 1. But let us look what happens with derivative. F prime of 1 is epsilon minus 1. F2 prime of 1 is 1. Therefore, lambda of 1 is what? 1 minus epsilon squared divided by f2 prime of 1 to the power 1 over 2. This is 1 minus epsilon, which is smaller than 1. So our test at the point x equal to 0 guarantees the existence of the solutions, which is 1 over epsilon, can be infinitely far from your point, but still, so we can see that. So this, again, one more confirmation that the local measurements for self-concordant functions, so they give us global information about our problem. So now let us look at the methods so which we can apply. And of course, so our main tool here is the Newton method. In this case, it is damped Newton method. Damped Newton method so is written like that. So the Newton direction is scaled in a certain way. Okay, this scale, so it is divided 1 plus the local norm of the gradient. Let's write it down. So lambda f of x, this is prime of x minus 1 f prime of x 1 over 2, local norm of the gradient, which is easily computable, of course, so we can always compute that. And so therefore it is called damped Newton method. So what we can prove about the efficiency of this scheme, so it is as follows. So we can decrease the value of our function, but certain quantity, so this is our function omega, dependent on the local norm of the gradient. Okay, let us prove this. So the proof is again trivial, and it is based on our inequalities which we just obtained. For that, we measure the distance between these two points in our metric and write it in terms of lambda. So if we substitute this stuff so in our formula, you can see that the step, the distance between these two points is lambda divided 1 plus lambda. This is a simple computation. Now, we have an upper bound for the function value at the new point in terms of the function omega star, so this guy. And again, by simple substitution, so you can do that yourself, you see that this value is exactly that. It is not even inequality. This is equality. This is equality. And this is it. So the inequality which we want to have. So what is the reason for this miracle, if you want? So when we have equality here, it is again so the story about the Fenchel conjugate property of these two functions. They are mutually Fenchel conjugate. And this, from that actually you see, so the difference between these two points is actually this, the gradient of function omega, the corresponding value, and all things like that. So there is some internal machinery which works, but in some sense for the proof, we even don't need to know all of that. We just substitute this stuff here, and we see that it is exactly that. Now, what is the reason for this coefficient in this damped Newton method? Again, the same as before. We have an upper approximation of our functions, okay, in this form. So just think that this guy is free. So it is just a y. And we want to minimize a free point y. We want to minimize this upper approximation in y. So if we do this, so the solution of this minimization problem in this free variable gives you exactly this formula. So again, the same as before. For computing new approximation, new good point, we just minimize the upper approximation of our function. This is exactly what was done here. The consequence, so if we say that in all our points, so the local norm of the gradient is bigger than the constant, okay, then we leave this region in this number of iterations. So it is, this is, yeah, I don't know, do you shoot this or not? So here it is written f of x0 minus f star. Okay. Since if our constant, if our local norm is bigger than some constant, function is below bounded, then so this reduction, so if this is big enough, so cannot take more iteration than f of x0 minus f of x star. after this number of iterations, we will ensure that the local norm of our gradient will be smaller than some constant. So this is the main consequence. Now, what about local convergence? What about local convergence? So, of course, we want to have them quadratic, but note that now our norms are local, so let us look what we can do with that. Actually, first of all, we need to decide in which terms we ensure the convergence of our algorithm. Yeah? So let us try to understand that. And again, recall that locally, our function is almost quadratic, which means that if our function, let us look what happens with just with quadratic function. Let us look how we can write down the residual, and the residual in this situation is just difference, okay, so between f of x and f star, this is 1/2 axx. We can write down it in another form. For example, it can be write down like this. Okay, the optimal value is 0. This is f2 prime of x multiplied by x minus x star. Okay? You see, for quadratic function, so this is the same. But we also can write it down in terms of the norm of the gradient. Okay. Again, the residual of the function so is the same as 1/2 of the squared local norm of the gradient. For quadratic functions, this is exactly the same measurements. And we have seen that our self-concordant function is the neighborhood of the solution is almost quadratic. Therefore, for self-concordant functions, these measurements are also more or less the same. For us, it doesn't matter in which way we measure this residual, because they are related one to another with some inequalities which become sharp when the residual goes to zero. Therefore, let us write down the rate of convergence in terms of the most convenient measure, the local norm of the gradient. And again, so it is convenient just because we are able to compute it. We are able to see this. So all this stuff for nonlinear function, we cannot compute. But this guy, so it is at our hands. So we are able to compute. So let us do this in terms of lambda. Okay. Is computable. So the theorem is then that if we are in our domain and the local norm of the gradient is smaller than 1, again, so we just have seen an example that this ensures the existence of the solution, then our step, just the Newton step without any damped, the standard Newton step, gives us a feasible point, and there is this rate of convergence, this rate of convergence, in terms of lambda, in terms of local norm of the gradient. Fine. So this is the theorem which we are going to prove. So actually, proof is not very difficult. So let me just keep. So we need some relations there. And I just want to put the scheme. Remember that we are working with the standard Newton method, not the damped Newton method. Okay. Standard Newton method. Now, and lambda, yeah, it is here, yes. Lambda, it is this. Now, let us look. So denote by P the difference between x plus and x, then, and lambda is our local norm, then the norm of P, so x plus minus x in this metric, if you measure this in this metric, this is exactly lambda. This is exactly lambda. And our assumption is that lambda is smaller than 1. Therefore, our next point is in this Dickin ellipsoid of the radius smaller than 1, and therefore it is feasible. Fine. First step is proved. Now, we need to estimate from above the local norm of the gradient at the next point. So what is it? This is the new gradient measured with respect to the new metric. So first of all, we replace this new metric at x plus by the old metric. Okay. We measure the same vector, new norm, but with the old metric. But then, in accordance to our theorem, so we need to introduce some, let me say, coefficients to have an upper bound for this stuff. You remember it was the fact that f2 prime of y greater or equal 1 minus r squared f2 prime of x. So this type of relation between the Hessian. So this was the lower bound for the Hessian at the new point, and from that, so we get an upper bound for the new Hessian. For the new Hessian in terms of the distance between these two points. So we have this inequality. And now we need just to estimate. So this is lambda, so we have already seen this. Okay, and we need to estimate the norm of the new gradient with respect measured at the old point. Let us look, yeah. You mean why we apply this? Yes, so when you have 1 over 1 plus lambda, so you have locally it will be worse, the convergence will be worse. We could apply that, but the formula will be a little bit worse than for the damped. Damped Newton method also converges quadratically, but since here we need only local convergence, fast local convergence, it is better to work directly with the quadratic approximation without this stuff which we use when we're measuring something about the points which are far. And now the points are very close. So therefore, this is the reason why we use this guy. So the new gradient, it is the same as that. So why this is true? Just because this is equal to 0. Yeah, this if x plus is computed by that, so this is equal to 0. But on the other hand, now we see that the new gradient is equal to the difference between the new gradient and prediction of the gradient at the new point. Okay, and this can be written in terms of this integral matrix J, for which actually we already wrote, I don't know, several slides ago, some bounds. Now, therefore, so let us estimate this stuff. So this is equality. Yeah, so the norm of, wait a moment. Yes, this is the new gradient at the old metric. So this is JP, this is new gradient. And now, so this guy is estimated by this product. Let us be careful and see what is this. What is this? What is this? So we had f2 prime of x minus 1 j p j p. What we are doing? So here we introduce the product f2 prime minus 1 half multiplied by f2 prime of x 1 half. We introduce this product here and here. Okay? Then if we do this and we denote by this product by y, then it will be the following: h y h y. So where h is this h. So this is divided by two parts, f2 prime of x minus 1/2 f2 prime of x minus 1/2. Okay, and then this multiply by that and multiply by that gives us h. And the same h we will have here. So this guy, it will be here multiplied by 1/2 of this, which goes there. Okay, and 1/2 of that, which stays before this. Okay, anyway, so choosing this notation, you can easily see that this is h, y, y, and h, y, y, so, and norm of y, okay, squared Euclidean already norm. This is f2 prime of x, pp. Okay. Norm of y Euclidean, what is it? This is, okay, let me write it like this. So if we say that this is f2 prime of x 1/2 p, f2 prime of x 1/2 p, this is the Euclidean norm of y square, so here. Okay, so then, so this scalar product in the standard Euclidean, the standard scalar product is exactly that, because this goes here with transposition. So using this trick, so we just represent this norm in this way, and now, so we just estimated by Euclidean norm of h multiplied already by the local norm of p. So this is the main trick in the proof, because now, so in view of corollary, you remember, so we had this inequality, we can estimate the matrix J from below the lower bound and upper bound. This was inequality several slides ago. And from that, so we see that what happens, H is our matrix. We multiply this inequality from the left and from the right by the inverse 1/2. Here we have identity matrix, and here we'll have identity. So then it will be minus lambda plus 1 over 3 lambda square identity matrix less or equal of h less or equal lambda 1 minus lambda again identity matrix. Okay, we have the lower and upper bounds for the eigenvalues of matrix H, and therefore its spectral norm is smaller, maximal absolute value is smaller than upper bound, maximum from upper bound, and minus lower bound. Yeah, so this, from this type of inequality, we get an upper bound for the maximal absolute value of matrix H. So, and this is almost it. So we compare these two guys, we see that this is stronger. So the norm of H is smaller than lambda divided by 1 minus lambda. This is also lambda square. So taking everything together, so we get this inequality. So again, so just more or less trivial estimate. So the only maybe non-trivial stuff is here. So when we introduce this factor plus and minus and estimate the eigenvalues of matrix H. This is it. So from this theorem, actually, so we have consequence. We have a description of the region of quadratic convergence for our function. So how we do that? We see lambda plus less or equal lambda. So this is lambda square. So we represented lambda multiplied by lambda divided by 1 minus lambda square. This is the theorem which we just proved. The new local norm is smaller than this stuff, square root from this guy. Now, we want to see the convergence, and this happens if the next lambda is smaller than the previous one. For that, the coefficient in the right-hand side of this inequality for lambda must be smaller than 1. So we solve this quadratic equation, and we see when equal to 1. Yeah. We solve this quadratic equation, and we see when, so the method starts to converge quadratically. And this solution is just a number. So this means they have the description of the region of quadratic convergence in an affine invariant way. What does it mean? It means that the local norm of the gradient, so which is an affine invariant characteristic, is smaller than something. So the solution of this equation is something like close to 1/3. And after that, so we can be sure that we have quadratic convergence of our scheme. I think so at this moment, so it is better to stop. So we continue next time. So questions? Yeah.
For this damped Newton method, the main assumption that we had alongside self-concordance is that the domain does not contain straight lines.
Yes.
And for the case, if it's not the case, if domain contains straight lines, do we need to use some regularization, like in cubic regularization?
You see, not actually, because this is a very special situation. Again, all Hessians, they contain global information. So the about the domain in some sense. Therefore, if you see at some point that the Hessian is degenerate along the line, this means that all Hessians are degenerate along this line. So this means that along this line, our function is linear. You don't need, therefore, along this line, so either so your function is unbounded, or it is just not sensitive. So therefore, you just need to go in the orthogonal direction. There, the Hessian will be non-degenerate.
But to determine this line, we need to compute eigenvalue of the
Hessian. No, well, in some sense, yes. But actually, usually it is quite visible. I mean, so it happens if you have a function like this, minus log of ax. So this is the typical example of degenerate Hessian. So the Hessian of this guy is what? A transpose divided by ax square. So you see all these Hessians, so they have a huge subspace, common joint subspace, where the function is not changing at all. So in some sense, you need to maybe introduce new variable, say, so tau is equal to ax, and work maybe in these new variables. So I mean that the barrier will be sensitive only to the image of x, not to the x itself. In the situation when the level sets, all level sets of function, they are like this. Okay, so they're not sensitive along some direction, so all of them are like this. Okay, therefore you need to optimize in the orthogonal direction. This situation which you cannot improve somehow in a fine invariant way, because even if what we discussed at some moment, you regularize your function with the Hessian at some point, so this Hessian will be also degenerate. So you cannot improve the situation by addition of, for example, squared Hessian or Hessian with cubic terms. So, yeah.
Doesn't it mean that all self-concordance functions must be in some way strongly convex, because we have inequality that
This is the way of, it is not necessary, no.
But can you switch to the slide where we discuss the qualities for self-concordant functions?
It is not on the blackboard?
No, it is not.
Long lecture.
Yeah.
Oh, this, for example,
yes.
Previous one, okay.
Yeah, so here we have the bounds for the scalar properties of difference and gradients.
Yes.
And if we take on the right-hand side the maximum over all pairs, then we get a bound. In some way, we can turn it into a definition of strongly convex functions.
Right? No, because look, so the self-concordant function is, for example, this guy. So minus log of 1 over x. Okay, it's second derivative. So gradient minus x, second derivative 1 over x squared. Okay, there is no uniform bound for the lower bound for this guy. So there is no straight line, but still, when x is big, this example, when you remember, so then the minimizer can be as far from your point as you want, shows that for strongly convex function, you can bounds for the domain. Here you don't, or they kind of strange. Yeah. No, it's not the case. Other questions? If not, this is it. Actually, today, as far as I understand, Christina sent to everybody the slides of the lecture. So therefore, if you want, you can look at them, and maybe you'll have more questions. Okay, thanks.